pastor and his wife went on a vacation. And where do you suppose they went? It was to a dude ranch. So where else would they go but other than Arizona, probably? They went to Arizona to this dude ranch, and they were having a good time of it, but he had not been raised around horses that much. So he was a little apprehensive about horses all the way. His wife had had more experience with horses, so she was a little more comfortable around them. But they went to this dude ranch, and they were enjoying themselves. But have you ever been to a dude ranch? The horses, a lot of times it seems like they know where home is, but they don't know where anything else is. And you try to ride them away from home, and it's, well, different story. Horses have a tendency to have a peculiar thing about them, and their name seems to reflect it. You know, Valium, that would be a horse to get, wouldn't it? Pokey, well, maybe not so much. The horse the pastor got to ride on this one particular day was named Reverse. He didn't quite know what to expect, so he asked the ranch hands, what is his particular trait? Because Reverse seems to refer to something in particular. And they said, yes, if you pull sharply on the reins, he will rear up and take a couple of steps back. He made a mental note that not to do that. Well, this one day, they were taking the horses to another pasture. They were taking several horses. So they asked him if he would like to go, and he said, yeah, I'd appreciate that. So he climbed up on Reverse, and they started taking the horses out. Everything was going very well. They took them to a pasture a short distance away, a mile or so away from where they were, the headquarters, and they put them in the pasture, and then they started back. Everything going well, just normal, everyday activity, riding a horse, you know, plug along. And then one of the ranch hands decided to make it a race. And away they went. Well, the pastor, of course, whoa! And the horse reared, took a couple of steps backwards. Reverse was true to his name. And then went down and took off like a bat shot from a cannon. A dead heat just took off, just going like crazy. Pastor said he thought it was kind of like a dead heat, but the problem was the word dead kind of stuck in his mind. And they're just tearing off down the road, right by a ditch, and the pastor got to looking in the ditch and wondering, which rock am I going to crack my head on? And then, of course, being a preacher, a text came to mind. Do preachers always have that? It just makes me wonder. Text came to mind. Exodus 15:1. I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed greatly. Horse and rider he has thrown into the sea. Comforting words as you're racing along. But the crazy part of it was, here he is, he's trying to hang on to this horse. They're going like crazy, and he is passing the high school kids on their mounts. And suddenly it is no longer terror he feels, but the adrenaline rush, this feeling of, this is tremendous. Man, this is great. If I don't get killed, this is wonderful. Well, by the time they'd pulled up at the fence, he was leading most of them. Fact is, there was four of the horsemen that he'd left behind. And he felt, this is tremendous. But the thing of it is, that was a whistle, wasn't it? The thing of it is, he could have missed out on that ride. All he had to do was say no to going on that ride. He had the choice of whether to take that ride or not. When he said yes, he would go on it. He had no idea what was going to happen. But he would never, never have had that feeling. That was the best ride of the whole period of time on the ranch. But he had the choice of taking the ride or not taking the ride, going with them fellows to return them horses to a pasture. He had no control over what was going to happen other than perhaps falling off the horse, trying to get off it when the ride started. And you know, in some respects, that's the same thing Peter had when he got out of the boat. In Matthew chapter 14, verse 29. Matthew chapter 14, verse 29. It talks about the one thing. And this is the one point we're going to focus on. A single phrase in about the middle of the verse. Peter started walking on the water. Last time I spoke, we talked about the call, because Peter had asked Jesus to, if it's you, command me to come to you in the boat, is what he asked for. And Jesus did command him. But now we're looking at Peter started walking on the water. There are so many other parts to this story, and we'll get to them later on in other talks. Because we're familiar with fear, we're familiar with failure, and we're familiar with storms. In the middle of this passage is that remarkable occurrence. Peter walked on the water. Can you imagine what Peter was feeling like? The memories that he was getting from this act in the middle of the storm. I can't believe it. Nobody actually thought I'd get out of that boat. That has to be one of the hardest things I've ever done. Trying to turn loose of the boat in this storm. And yet, the water was firm under my feet. How can that be? I was afraid that I'd die, and yet I find I'm actually doing what Jesus is doing, walking on the water. I don't know how it's working, but I'm walking on the water. Something or someone is holding me up. I'm beginning to understand now. It's true. He really is the one. I don't think things will ever be the same after this. I don't know how I can ever settle being in the boat again. But can you imagine, just try to imagine Peter looking at Jesus and Jesus looking at Peter as they're both walking on the water. Getting out of the boat was Peter's great gift to Jesus, and walking on the water was Jesus' great gift to Peter. You know, most of us have always heard these messages about how powerful God is. Scripture is full of images. He's a rock. He's a fortress. Proverbs 18:10 says he's a tower. He's a king. He's a warrior. We're told that God makes the earth tremble by a look. He makes the mountains smoke at a touch. And when he raises his voice, the earth melts. That's what it says in Psalms 46:6. But Jesus' confidence is so much greater than his disciples. There's another storm. He's in the boat. Jesus is sleeping. Now, how many of you have ever been in a boat that's been in a bad storm? Some have. I served aboard a couple of aircraft carriers, and we went through some typhoons, and our bow was 80 feet above the water in calm seas, and I've watched water come over the bow. Of course, the ship is pitching and rolling and rocking and all that. My father's ship went down in storms. But the thing of it is, they awakened Jesus. The disciples are afraid for their lives. Jesus walked over to the side of the boat, and he talks to nature. Can you imagine anybody talking to nature? Peace, be still. And the wind stopped. What a thing to see, to hear. But Peter, getting out of the boat, realized, as he says, he is the one. He spoke and nature listened. But we come up with the problem. We can hear all these things about how great our God is, how strong he is. Peace, be still. But information alone is not sufficient enough to create courageous human beings. We can receive much information designed to assure me that God's power is sufficient. But that information alone does not transform us. It does not transform us or our heart or our character. In order for such a transformation to take place, certain actions and certain experiences are required. When it came time for the Israelites to cross the River Jordan, Now, we want to remember when they were going to do that, the river was in flood stage. And it was interesting as I was rereading this and so forth and relooking at my facts in the Bible. The ark was supposed to be about 3,000 feet in front of the Israelites. Over half a mile in front. They were to take the ark and then they were to go to the River Jordan. The water did not part until the priests stepped into the water. They had to get their feet wet first. They had to take that first step. Then the priests walked in with the ark to the middle of the river. Can you imagine what that was like? An invisible dam. Because the water just stopped there. It was still flowing from above. But no water was going down into the Red Salt Sea? It was a sea down below where the river was going. The water stopped flowing into there. But the water was still building up. It says it built up to Adam. That's going way back there, isn't it? Oh, I'm sorry, that was a different thing. But it did. The water actually pushed back to a town called Adam. How high a dam was this? But it stopped right there. And then they walked through on dry land until all the Israelites were through. And then the priest came through with the ark the rest of the way. Makes me wonder, and this is just, was there a flood downstream from then after the dam was removed? It doesn't say, but interesting thought. How do we know whether I'm getting out of the boat in any area of my life? How do you know if you're getting out of the boat in any area of your life? What am I? What are you doing that you could not do apart from the power of God? Peter could in no way walk on that water without the power of God. If you want to walk on the water, you have to be willing to get your feet wet first. Then you can discover it was worth the risk. When I take the risk of giving generously, I discover that I can really trust God to take care of me. But I have to give first. I have to get my feet wet first. When I risk the use, or when I risk using my spiritual gift, I can know the joy of being used by God. But I have to get my feet wet first. God generally helps people's faith grow by using them. And they have to take that first step. When God called Moses to get out of his boat to talk to Pharaoh about the children of Israel, Moses balked. He said, "No, you know what? I can't talk very well. It'd be better if you use somebody else. Aaron's got a good, you know." And Jesus had to or that God had to help him a bit. Throw down your staff. And he did. And it became a what? A serpent. And then he was told to pick up the serpent by the tail. I don't know how many of you, Dave out there has had an experience with a rattlesnake. When I was younger and foolisher, a little more foolish, when I was growing up, we'd take sticks. Because I grew up in Colorado, we had rattlesnakes around, and we'd see a rattlesnake, we'd take our stick and find a stick and hold its head down, and then we'd grab it behind the head and we'd take it with us wherever we went or whatever we were going to do with it. It was just something that we did. Foolish, but we did. And as such, to pick one up by the tail, as Moses was told to do, to pick up that serpent by the tail, that's not something I would have ever done. And Moses reached down, grabbed its tail, and it became his staff again. So the faith that Moses showed helped build his faith. But God wanted Moses to learn something about the first step principle. We can call it the first step principle. God was faithful. But Moses had to pick it up first. Moses had to take that first step for God to then to step in. When the Israelites marched to the Red Sea, was it already parted? No. They had to go to the sea before it would part. Over and over again in Scripture, that kind of stuff is talked about. Naaman had to wash 7 times. Did he stop at once? No. He had to do all 7. He had to take the first step. Gideon, from troops numbering 32,000 down to 300. Before God allowed them to mix it up with the Midianites. The loaves and the fishes had to be removed from the basket before they were multiplied. If I am going to experience a greater measure of God's power in my life, It will usually involve that first step principle. I have to get my feet wet. There are people who torment themselves over having too little faith. They're certain that their lack of faith is the reason for an unanswered prayer, for their spiritual weakness, or for a sense of feeling that they're distanced from God. It's the devil who puts this kind of thought into your mind. He says, you must believe better. You must believe more. Your faith is not very strong and is totally insufficient. And so you start despairing. You wrestle with the doubt. I'm going to try harder to have more faith. It's something I've got to do. But faith is not something you get from trying harder. It'd be the same thing as somebody saying to you, I don't believe in Old Faithful. What's Old Faithful? It's a geyser in Yellowstone Park. I've seen it. I don't know. Has everybody here seen Old Faithful or depictions of it? Okay, depictions of it. Every so much period of time, it always blows its top, spews water up into the air, nice, steamy, I think it's sulfur type water. Probably doesn't smell well. I've been there. I don't remember what it's like. But you can set your clock, basically, by the time element of Old Faithful. Thus, its name, Old Faithful. How would you be able to tell somebody to believe more in Old Faithful? Your best bet would be to say, go and watch. Study Old Faithful. And that's the same thing that we have to do with God. How can we believe in Him? I can't tell you how. You have to study. You have to understand. And only in believing and studying and understanding will your faith grow and you learn to trust. How much faith do I need? Just enough faith to take a step. For Hebrews 11:6 says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. You need to get out of your boat a little every day. Perhaps by saying at the beginning of the day, what do I need? Where do I need to have just a little step in the water? God, help me to find or to show me where I need to get my feet wet that day. And as you do, your faith will deepen and your spiritual comfort zone will widen. Instead of letting your fear put you into avoidance mode, it may be precisely the indicator telling you where God wants to use you. But you'll have to get your feet wet to find out first. Sometimes people in Scripture get motivated to trust God in remarkable ways. Nehemiah, rebuilding Jerusalem, he was moved to risk a king's displeasure and lethal opposition to rally God's people. David could not tolerate a giant mocking God. He was moved to risk his life to defend his God. Elijah could not tolerate the barbaric practice of pagan idolatry. He was moved to take on all the prophets of Baal single-handedly. Maybe God is calling you to trust Him at some point of frustration in your life. Walking on the water is not about doing some great thing. In fact, by yourself, you can do nothing of lasting value. It is about what God longs to do with you by His power and grace. But you see, first, you have to get your feet wet. You have to trust Him. no one ever regretted trusting Christ more. Ever. Did you catch that? No one has ever regretted trusting Christ more. Our closing hymn, number 590, 590. Father, we are so thankful that you give us the opportunity to build our faith. If we can just get our feet a little wet. So be with each one of us, Lord. every person here. Guide them, direct them, give them the strength they need. You're there always, Lord. Help us to reach for you. Guide us and firm the water under our feet, Lord, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.